judge in Missouri has refused to grant a new trial to a man who has spent 24 years in prison. Lamar Johnson has been serving a life sentence since 1994 when he was convicted of killing Marcus Boyd in a drug dispute. However, the prosecutors now say Johnson was wrongfully convicted. So why won't this judge give him a new trial? I'm joined now by Johnson's attorney, Lindsay Runnels. Thank you so much, Lindsay, for taking the time. I mean, this isn't you making this argument. This is the prosecutor saying that their colleagues flubbed this. Why are they pointing to their finger right at the prosecutors?
Yeah, that's right, Lynn, and thank you for having me. After an investigation, the circuit attorney's office determined by clear evidence that Lamar Johnson was in fact innocent. And after that conclusion, decided to move forward with a motion for new trial to vacate his sentence. And that was the start of the litigation in St. Louis City. The judge last Friday dismissed that motion for new trial. And so we will appeal that ruling. I believe the circuit attorney will as well, because we believe there is a mechanism in Missouri for an innocent man to walk free.
And I know some of the reasons that the prosecutors point to is the timeline didn't match up. There's no way he could have committed the crime. Also, that there were witnesses that recanted their statements, that there were witnesses, that there were allegations they were possibly paid for their statements. There's a number of things that led prosecutors to believe, listen, there was serious misconduct here. So why did the judge refuse to give him a new trial? From what I understand, it all came down to, among other things, a 15-day window that the lawyers missed here.
That's true. The evidence of innocence in this case is overwhelming. The circuit attorney's office recognized that. The court relied on a statute of limitations of 15 days whereby a defendant can file a motion for new trial. Certainly, that deadline is long past, in part due to the misconduct of the state in hiding evidence of Lamar Johnson's innocence. The state moved for new trial in this instance, and we believe Missouri case law recognizes, and rightfully so, recognizes an exception for manifest injustice like we see here, the conviction of an innocent person, whereby those procedural rules can be set aside, otherwise a perversion of justice would occur. That's what the case law says. We believe Lamar Johnson's case fits squarely into the exception, and we will be asking the Court of Appeals to recognize that this case sits in those exceptional circumstances.
I know all of this comes down to the legalese that you're laying out. This is a man's life. He spent 24 years in prison for a crime you say he didn't commit. Right. How is he reacting to all of this, that it came down to a 15-day window?
You know, he's disappointed, certainly, as are his entire legal team. When you have someone who's innocent and you know your evidence is overwhelming and you have the state agreeing with you, you know, we believe it's enough. In this case, it's not quite yet enough, but we are confident that justice will eventually prevail in this case, because while we talk a lot and we quibble about deadlines and procedural mechanisms, the case is rather simple. Lamar Johnson is innocent, and there is no statute of limitations on innocence, and there's no expiration on justice. And so we believe that there is a mechanism available for Lamar Johnson and available for the circuit attorney's office.
We reached out to the judge involved in this, asked for a statement. She declined, but the public information officer said to us simply, just read the entire judgment, which we did, and it details why they say their hands were really tied here. The deadline wasn't the only thing. They said that there are other ways that you could possibly get a new trial. It's not really on them. So as you say, you're going to appeal. Are you confident that you're going to get him out?
You know, I am confident that justice will eventually prevail in this case. It can't be the state of the law that there is an innocent person that has no remedy, especially in a system whose touchstones are, you know, due process of law and equal access. I do believe that eventually we will get a court to recognize the incredible injustice and the sobering misconduct that led to the conviction of Lamar Johnson. I am confident about that. It shouldn't be so difficult, though, and we should also be having a conversation about that. And there's certainly a role for the legislature to play, and the court pointed that out. There is a role for all of the players to play here. However, it can't be that there's still no mechanism while we all try and figure that out.
Well, an innocent man is there in prison, as you are saying he is. Lindsay Runnels, thank you for being with me. We appreciate it.
Thank you for having me.
And if you want my take, here's the simple truth. We may never know how many Lamar Johnsons there are out there. The Innocence Project shines the light on a few of them. And if you read their stories, you realize just one is too many. Over three decades, they have exonerated nearly 400 people, innocent people, who they say spend an average of 14 years in prison before they're released, if they're released. I mean, you can read about them yourself on innocenceproject.org. One of them was Brian Banks, a man whose story is now on the big screen. He spent 5 years in prison for a rape he never committed, and with the help of the California Innocence Project, he was exonerated a decade later. And he sat down with me just recently, hoping that his story is a reminder to you that you're not your tragedy or your trauma.
It's a testament to life itself and what we go through on a day-to-day basis, that things will be, we will experience things that are of the unexpected, of the unwanted, but it's not what you go through, but how you allow it to affect you and what you choose to do moving forward.
Others aren't as lucky to have a Hollywood story told about them, like Rodney Patrick McNeil. He's a probation officer who arrived home to find his wife brutally murdered back in 1997. And because they had a volatile marriage and prior calls to the house, he was arrested for her murder, despite an impossible timeline to murder and ransack their home, despite unidentified hair on his wife's clothes and no blood on his clothes. A jury convicted him, even though a friend told the judge that someone else admitted to the murder. The judge would not reverse his conviction. And the cost that you're paying for some of these alleged wrongful convictions, in Rodney's case, it's $1.5 million and counting. The system is flawed, but what we do about it is not. And that's the simple truth.